Thank you very much. The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 23628 in the name of Christine Graham on Citizens Advice Scotland Helps More People. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Can I ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now? And I call on Christine Graham to open the debate.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I thank everyone who signed my motion to allow this important and timorous debate to take place. For the work of CABs is close to my heart. My first encounter was many moons ago as a solicitor when I volunteered for evening surgeries at my then local CAB. I soon found out the wealth of expertise there, sometimes putting the lawyer in me to shame. I also found out that folk usually turned up at the last minute when court orders have been served or debt collectors were at the door. Indeed, there won't be an MSP who doesn't value their work. The text of the motion indicates the vast impact the many CABs have throughout Scotland. Teasing out some figures, in 2019-20, they dealt with 188,000 clients, securing 170 million overall, representing £16 in client gain for every £1 of cost to fund the service. A service arguably even more vital in this COVID pandemic, with its impact on every aspect of our lives, all committed to delivering the services despite all the restrictions. So the motion describes the Scotland-wide picture. But let me focus on the three CABs in Midlothian, South Tweeddale and Lauderdale, my constituency, to emphasise the impact on my constituents. I'll start with Pennycook CAB, then Central Borders and Galla Shields, and finally Peebles CAB. There are others, but these are the three I will highlight. In Pennycook, as elsewhere, advisers have been equipped for home working with secure access to their advice system and case recording system, allowing them to provide the same high quality, confidential and impartial advice as normal during these challenging times. Pennycook CAB, established more than 80 years ago during a period of crisis, ironically during this COVID crisis, has dealt with 5,500 clients, helped with 9,000 questions and secured almost 2 million for clients. They completed 960 forms, 89 benefit appeals, and indeed 4,000 benefit issues and 250 housing problems. And that's just a glimpse of what they do. In Central Borders Citizens Advice Bureau in Galla Shields, there is a similar tally, helping 1,830 clients and dealing with nearly 7,000 issues. The top five inquiry categories there being Social Security, nearly 3,000 issues. And of course, that's a category of complexity with the labyrinth of the benefits system. Debt, 1,004 issues. Employment, 395 issues. Housing, 322. And referrals to a food bank, 239 times. In total, clients received a reported financial gain of over £1.5 million as a result of advice given by the Bureau, 75% of which was connected to Social Security entitlements, entitlements which were due to those clients, but they couldn't work out how to access them. It also gives specialist advice and information on PensionWise, PASS, the Patient Advisory Support Service, Kinship Care, Citizens Advice Consumer Service, that's for postal and utility issues, ASAP, Armed Services Advice Project, the EU Settlement Scheme, Help to Claim Universal Credit, and the Money Talk Team. And it too adapted quickly to working during lockdown. In Peebles, that's CAB, the story of help continues. From 1st April 2019 to 31st of March 2020, it saw 888 clients and had 2,144 client contacts, and again saw over 350,000 in client gain. The following financial year, the pattern was very much repeated. Now, stats are important, but every statistic is a real person in need. So to bring that home, to put a face to those facts, here is an example. A client was referred when she was pregnant with her fifth child and her partner was in prison. She had 4,000 in rent arrears and owed 3,000 for utilities. Her problems were caused when she was transferred to Universal Credit, as she didn't know that she should pay the rent. She was also subject to the benefit cap. To add more pain, she had thyroid problems and suffered from anxiety and depression. Little wonder she suffered from anxiety and depression. So understandably, she was completely overwhelmed, and who wouldn't be in those circumstances? So what did Citizens Advice Bureau do? It did benefit check and organised discretionary housing payment to top up her rent and arranged for rent to be paid directly to the landlord. It helped her apply for disability living allowance for a disabled child and other benefits for her children. A money advisor negotiated the manageable repayment of rent arrears and utility debts. And the Citizens Advice Bureau organised small grants to help her to buy phone top-ups to allow her to access her Universal Credit account and keep in touch. And finally, it made food bank referrals and obtained a small grant for food following a financial crisis. But it did more. Once everything was stabilised, the client felt able to look for work. The CAB did better off calculations and went through her financial options. The client was thrilled when she was able to obtain work. The CAB accessed grant money to help her purchase shoes, uniform, and a bus pass for a new job. One woman, five children, and a better and stable future for all of them. These stories are replicated throughout the Citizens Advice Bureau offices. So we owe, as a society, perhaps even more so as politicians on behalf of our constituents, huge debt of gratitude to our Citizens Advice Bureau, those who are employed there, and the many dedicated volunteers who do so much for many folk on the edge and, quite frankly, desperate. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I now call Rona Mackay to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I thank Adrian for bringing this debate to the Parliament today? I cannot speak highly enough about Citizens Advice Bureau and welcome every opportunity I have to speak about the great work that they do. Presiding Officer, the experience we've all had over the past year with this unprecedented pandemic sharply brings into focus the crucial service Citizens Advice Scotland provides. The statistics in Christine Graham's motion are absolutely phenomenal and really say it all about CAB and their service throughout Scotland. Before being elected, I was on the board of Eastern Bartonshire Citizens Advice Bureau. I saw how the amazing army of volunteers worked hand in hand with staff, juggling with often very tight budgets, and they all had one aim, to help people. The Citizens Advice Network in Scotland is the largest independent advice service in the country, made up of 59 individual Citizens Advice Bureau, each of which is an independent charity in its own right. The Bureau offer free, independent, impartial and confidential advice to clients on matters ranging from debts and benefits to employment rights and fuel poverty. Scotland's first Citizens Advice Bureau opened in Glasgow in 1939 during the Second World War. At that time, inquiries related to wartime issues such as tracing relatives whose homes had been bombed and lost ration books. Now they're dealing with inquiries relating to another global crisis, COVID-19. They've adapted quickly and remain contactable for advice by phone and email. CAVs have also provided face-to-face advice for vulnerable clients in essential circumstances. Between April to November last year, the Bureau issued over 643,000 pieces of advice on the virus. They also published regular data reports tracking changes in the type of advice people are seeking during the pandemic. This helps provide the best service for clients, but it also allows us to act as an early warning system for government on the impact of the policies that we make and what they're having on the ground. In my constituency of Strathkelvin and Bearsden, the CAB office is based in Kirkintilloch, very close to my office, and they've been an invaluable source of help and advice to the office over the years. And they've been exceptionally busy. In 2019 to 2020, they dealt with 8,832 benefits claims, 886 housing inquiries, and many, many others. In fact, they handled 17,393 cases that year. My office regularly hold joint surgeries with CAB, and last year they assisted with helping EU citizens apply for settled status at special surgeries we held on the issue. Indeed, Citizens Advice Scotland Specialist Service is the EU Citizens Support Service and is funded by the Scottish Government and Home Office. Free and impartial and designed to help EU citizens and their families as they apply to continue living in the UK after the 30th of June this year. The service has helped more than 11,000 people since it launched. As the motion says, investing in the Citizens Advice Network is an investment in our communities. For every pound invested in our core advice funding, they unlock £16 for citizens, and that money can be life-changing for individuals. Citizens Advice Network has a footprint in every community across Scotland, driven by over 2,300 volunteers, and they contributed almost 750,000 hours of their time in 2019 to 2020. It's quite awesome. In November, they launched the Money Map tool, which brings together all the options for how people can improve their incomes and cut their living costs through issues such as housing, benefits and energy bills, and they direct them to online sites where they can access these options. They also launched Big Energy Saving Month campaign to give people the power to save time, money and energy just through everyday actions. The campaign offered free and independent energy price comparison tool as well, highlighting the many ways you can improve energy efficiency and access lower tariffs, etc. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, Citizens Advice Scotland is indeed our national treasure, and I thank them and the hundreds of volunteers for everything that they do to offer help and reassurance to so many people. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by James Kelly.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to also thank Christine Graham for bringing this debate to the Scottish Parliament and the opportunity to provide us to acknowledge the important work of Citizens Bureau located across Scotland. There are 59 of them, independent, impartial and offering confidential advice to clients. In 2019 and 20, Citizens Advice Bureau in the Lothian region supported over 21,000 clients, helping to gain £14 million and providing advice to some of the most deprived in our communities on issues including benefits, debt, immigration, employment and housing. The motion rightly thanks staff and volunteers for their ongoing work to support clients. Prior to the pandemic, I met with Carrie Nealon, manager of the Livingston CEB, who had contacted me regarding Scottish Legal Aid Board grant funding. I was very impressed at both Karen and her team's depth of knowledge and passion to ensure they achieve the best possible outcome for their clients. Trained volunteers are the heart of the CEB, and they are invaluable in delivering their service and helping people find a way forward with the problems they face. And I was a member of the tribunals that heard appeals on DLA and PIP. Often CEB represented clients. They did it both professionally and made sure that the client felt safe and secure and gave the best evidence possible. During this particular crisis, I've been reminded how essential the voluntary sector and volunteers are to our society. It has been an astonishing effort. I want to commend CEB across Scotland for the speed at which they adapted to the COVID-19 pandemic and resulting lockdowns, ensuring they retained contact for advice by phone, email, providing face-to-face advice for vulnerable clients in essential circumstances. The universal credit system has had to cope with a huge uplift in applications since the start of this crisis, increasing from an average of 20,000 claims per month in 2019 to over 110,000 between 1st March and 7th April 2020, highlighting the impact the pandemic is having on people's finances. The Citizens Advice Service had been pivotal in raising awareness of the financial support available to people via the Scottish Citizens Advice Helpline. This support will continue to be an important role once the lockdown ends, and a number of people will not be returning to the jobs that they held at the beginning of the crisis. Student Advice Scotland rightly point out that they have the ability through the services they offer and the people they reach to provide an early warning system to government, as we can see the changes in circumstances and how this will affect policies. This is hugely important, and as we begin to assess the long-term effect of the pandemic, it is vital government and politicians understand contribution DAB, both now and in the future, will make. An important part of this is making sure that there is adequate funding of Citizen Advice Bureau to ensure the long-term sustainability. Many CAB provide a range of services on behalf of local authorities. However, the sad reality is that the Scottish SNP government does not give councillors the fair funding deals they deserve. The amount of money the SNP government gives to local authorities has fallen by 276 million in real terms since 2013-14. Yet in the same period, the SNP government's budget from the UK government has increased by more than 1 billion or 3.1% in real terms. If councils do not have the resources available to fund the important services many CAB deliver on their behalf, there is a danger that they will have to be closed down or have reduced numbers. Can I end by thanking Citizen Advice Scotland and the Citizen Advice Bureau, not just for the advice and support you have provided consumers during this pandemic, but also for the free access quality information you advise you have offered since 1939, adapting and broadening your services and advice to reflect the changing nature of issues affecting consumers. Long may it continue, and thank you for all your hard work.
Thank you very much. I call James Kelly to be followed by Maurice Corrie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I first of all start by thanking Christine Graham for bringing this important debate forward to the Parliament this evening. What the contributions already are showing that is allowing members to highlight and to pay tribute to the local Citizens Advice Bureau and volunteers, but also the tremendous work that's done across the 59 offices throughout Scotland. I think the fact is highlighted in the briefing provided by Citizens Advice Scotland that it's helped people to the tune of £170 million, shows the remarkable job that's carried out in all these locations. I think the pandemic that we are dealing with currently has clearly been very challenging for individuals and communities, and never before have we needed a robust and supportive Citizens Advice network. As people have found themselves in far too often in vulnerable and difficult positions. I want to pay tribute to one of the local offices in the Glasgow region, which I represent, the Rutherglen and Cambuslang Citizens Advice Bureau, which runs under the very, very effective stewardship of Sharon Hampson, the manager. Since 1st of April last year up until the 20th of February this year, dealt with an astonishing 2,912 individuals. That amounted to 9,296 cases. And incredibly, they were able to help people to the tune of £1.163 million. That is a fantastic job that they've done across such a small area. The main issues that they've been dealing with over the past year, unsurprisingly, are benefits, employment and debt. Clearly, as other members have highlighted, there have been benefit challenges during COVID as people's circumstances have changed. And when that happens, individuals, worry how they're going to deal with that, and they need somebody to turn to, and the local Citizens Advice offices are excellent at providing practical support in people dealing with difficult circumstances. In addition to that, there's been an awful lot of employment issues. We get that as MSPs, but the Citizens Advice Bureau have been very good at not only providing advice, but pointing people in the correct direction in terms of support, whether employment circumstances have changed, or perhaps there are employers who we're maybe not operating appropriately within the COVID guidelines. All these citizens' advice bureaus, including Rutherglen and Cambuslang, couldn't operate without the volunteer network. It's been very difficult for them over the past year, but they've continued to make themselves available either over the phone or online when the offices haven't been able to open. And the numbers that they've been able to service, as I've quoted, show what a fantastic job that they've done. So I think what the debate is highlighting is that there are a lot of people struggling with serious issues in Scotland, in employment, debt, benefit issues, and the role that Citizens Advice Scotland has played in stepping in to support and help individuals has been a very welcome one. And I think it's excellent that we've had this debate this evening in order to pay tribute to that work and to highlight the fact that I'm sure it will continue to work very robustly in the future. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. And I call Maurice Corry to be followed by Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too would like to join members in thanking Christine Graham for bringing this most important debate this evening to Parliament. The work of Citizens Advice Scotland to provide free, independent and confidential advice is certainly worthy of our utmost appreciation. I strongly support the Citizens Advice Bureau, and I know they do a lot of work for our veterans in Scotland. I've seen this working out through the ASAP programmes and other programmes that we have. And as a councillor, I saw the need to robustly fund through the councils, because remember, it is based on the elected members of councils to elect a budget line every year, so that if they don't get the money right, we don't have open Citizens Advice Bureaus. Now, in Argyll and Bute, for example, when I was on the council until 2016, we had the choice of opening a centre in Helensburgh, Oban and out Campbelltown. I could only get enough money to fund it for Helensburgh, simply because we had the base and things like that, and obviously issues and close to Dumbarton. So it was really scandalous that we couldn't actually open in a need of an area which needed a deprivation in Campbelltown and also in Oban. Now, what worries me is there needs to be a much more fundamental review of the underpinning of Citizens Advice Bureaus and how it's done, because you cannot leave it at the whim of a vote, basically, at council level. So we need to look at that, and I'm all for it being done by councils, but we need to have a more robust system to get that in place, because there are two areas that are crying out for that help. Now, during 2019 and 20 alone, the Citizens Advice Network assisted one in every 24 adults in Scotland, and this points to an incredible reach that they are helping our communities. Now, the Citizens Advice Network relies on its volunteers, each person open-minded, happy to listen and able to offer impartial advice without preconceived ideas or judgment. And this approachability is key to how it operates. And I join my colleagues in commending their continual vital contribution over this time. Through this provision of support and the listening ear of its staff, Citizens Advice Scotland is well placed to influence improvement in policies. It gathers together any troubling experiences or complaints, which gradually informs its recommendations for wider policy changes on the citizens' behalf. And the presence of a Citizens Advice Scotland is sorely needed. Its support, rooted in expert knowledge and experience, has positively impacted the lives of those they help, and in many cases has helped to ward off unemployment, homelessness or bankruptcy, for example. Of course, the COVID-19 pandemic has affected nearly every corner of our lives, and for many people in Scotland, the pandemic has served to create an increase in problems even further. And the Citizen Advice Bureaus have responded amazingly, given the challenges that they face, and have sought to stay just as connected and available for those in need of advice and support. And whether through their website or over the phone, and for those more vulnerable in need of essential assistance, CABs are often chosen to maintain face-to-face advice. And since April 2020, the service has helped over 22,000 people with Scotland's Citizen Advice Helpline alone, and launched in response to rising concerns, particularly with benefits, debt, housing and employment. My own region of Scotland is fortunate to have a number of Citizen Advice Bureaus, and I know the staff and volunteers in the Western Bartonshire and Helensburgh Bureaus have continued to make themselves available to local residents throughout the pandemic, throughout all hours, working to ensure clients understand their options and helping to minimise and mitigate the issues they face. And these teams, like all those across the network of Citizens Advice Network, have collated together specific advice relating to the wide-ranging impact of COVID-19 and covering employment rights and benefits entitlements, as well as crisis guidance and support. And to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, the place Citizens Advice Scotland occupies in our community is wholly needed and very welcome. And as a lifeline to so many people who are living through difficult and challenging times, this service, built on the commitment of its staff and volunteers, deserves ample credit and for its advice and in-depth support and representation. And I do commend to this House that we need to look at the funding of the operation and of the organisation, because we certainly need to bolster it up at local council level. And anything the Cabinet Secretary can do to look at that, I would be enormously grateful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call Beatrice Wishart to be followed by Elaine Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be taking part in this debate and thank Christine Graham for bringing it forward. The valuable work of Citizens Advice Scotland, not only in her area but across Scotland, is well covered in her motion. Helping unlock over £170 million for their clients is a remarkable achievement. Other members have spoken in the debate about the great work done by the Scottish Citizens Advice Bureau network as a whole. It is a service that we cannot do without. And as I've said in the past, if the CAB network didn't exist, we would have to invent it. Every day, Citizens Advice Bureau help people avoid debt, poverty and homelessness. They help clients complete benefit forms and assist with tribunal and court outcomes. And they offer free, impartial, independent and confidential advice. Their work has continued during the pandemic, as they could be contacted for advice by phone and email. A staggering 643,000 pieces of advice were issued between April and November 2020. I'm sure all members are proud to support the Bureau in their area. I would like to reflect on the work of the Citizens Advice Bureau in Shetland, run by Karen Jonsson and her team of paid staff and volunteers. During the last year, Shetland Islands CAB has delivered advice to nearly 1,400 individuals on over 5,000 issues. Financial support has been the main focus, with 63% of advice relating to benefits, and advisors have carried out 523 benefit checks to ensure people can maximise their incomes. Karen notes that demand for advice on employment has grown, while energy advice to tackle high energy costs represented around 8% of inquiries. There was a noticeable growth in demand for advice on fuel debt and referrals for emergency fuel vouchers. And this is in line with the trend I've seen in my own casework, with serious issues of poor customer service, misinformation about tariffs, switching, changing meters from energy suppliers. This is all linked to the quite appalling levels of fuel poverty in island areas, as figures released yesterday by the Scottish Government demonstrate. Shetland's Bureau has helped clients achieve a financial gain of over £1.25 million and clearly represents a much needed boost for household incomes during the pandemic period. It's important to also recognise the boost that this gives to local economies, as that money will be spent on essentials in local shops and businesses. I'm pleased to report that despite the shift to remote delivery, clients of the Shetland Bureau have reported very high satisfaction rates, with 94% happy with access to advice. Specialist energy advice is just one of the services that Shetland CAB offers, and innovative use has been made of new technology to deliver remote energy and money advice clinics. The Bureau is part of a pilot project led by the NHS to use Near Me video calling software to deliver advice. The Bureau is particularly concerned about reaching isolated older people and those without digital access, and is working with partnership agencies and community groups to meet the needs of the most vulnerable in the community. Finally, it is important to recognise the vital work of the Citizens Advice Service Network in terms of immigration advice, and especially recently with the EU Citizens Support Service. This free and impartial service offers help to EU citizens and their families as they apply to continue living in the UK after 30th of June 2021. So far, it has helped 11,000 people since the service, which is funded by the Scottish Government and the Home Office, was launched. Deputy Presiding Officer, I concur with the sentiments expressed in the motion, and I thank all staff and all volunteers across the network for all that they do for our citizens.
Thank you very much, and I call Elaine Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and like others, can I congratulate Christine Graham for bringing forward this debate and join her, of course, in thanking all the CAB staff and volunteers who are under enormous pressure during this ongoing pandemic as the economic situation worsens. During this difficult time, it is impressive that they've managed to launch the Scotland Citizens Advice Helpline, assisting thousands of people in addition to the normal services they provide, and along with the new Money Map tool to help households budget more effectively. The independent nature of each Citizens Advice Bureau's being managed locally and helping within each community means, of course, that they can tailor the service to meet the needs of local people in a very unique way. Giving support and advocacy within communities is a powerful instrument in fighting for social justice. And I know well the excellent service offered in my local bureau in Coatbridge, run by Marion Tobin and her team. And like other bureaus across central Scotland, and indeed right across Scotland, they provide invaluable help to constituents. The chair of the Coatbridge Bureau is my friend and former MP, Sir Tom Clarke, and I was pleased to see the Bureau, along with the local community, recently celebrate Tom's well-earned knighthood. In my 17 years as constituency member, I worked very closely with the local CAB, who were in the same building as my office was, and in particular with CAB's housing specialist, Jim Melvin, who undoubtedly prevented many of my constituents from losing their homes. Knowing how vital these services are, like many, I was concerned at the news last year of proposals to cut funding to bureaus and other advice services affecting those who desperately need help. That's the last thing that you would expect during these difficult times. After all, as Christine Graham said, every pound of funding for core advice services enables £16 of gains for clients. I do understand that the threat still hangs over the services and it really must be lifted. The reports and statistics provided by Citizens Advice Scotland are also invaluable for policymakers. And their work during the pandemic has allowed us to map what's happening to the economy and the growing concerns and worries of citizens. It's therefore imperative that the Scottish Government does guarantee adequate funding for advice services. As others have said, across central Scotland in 2019-20, benefits was the single biggest area for which advice was sought from bureaus. Research has shown that £460 million lies in unclaimed benefits in Scotland each year. It's a scandal that so much money, which is supposed to lift our most vulnerable out of poverty, sits unclaimed. Unlocking this money is one of the key benefits of the services provided by the CAB. And across the UK, Entitled To estimates over £15 billion is being unclaimed by low-income households. Those figures are staggering, and they mean that millions of the most vulnerable are not getting the help that they're entitled to. Both the UK Government and the Scottish Government need to increase their efforts to make sure that everyone can understand what their legitimate entitlements are and make it easier for them to claim that amount. I really hope that as Social Security Scotland evolves, they will take some of the burden from the Citizens Advice Network. They should create a more transparent and accessible system for claimants, as well as fulfilling their aim of putting dignity, fairness and respect at the heart of everything they do. Citizens Advice warn us that levels of personal debt are soaring and are becoming unmanageable for many, and we need to pay attention to this warning. If the £20 universal credit uplift ends, then universal credit will fall below 2013 values in real terms. And this is very worrying when there are 480,000 people in Scotland claiming universal credit, many with families. As government statistics show that around 446 people were still making new claims for universal credit every hour in the first week of 2021, I also fully support the Joseph Rowntree Foundation and the hashtag Keep the Lifeline campaign in calling for a commitment to keep that uplift for at least a year. If they fail to do that, then I hope the Scottish Government will be able to use its devolved powers to somehow make up that difference. Presiding Officer, the pandemic has shown how financial security can quickly vanish and many have had to claim benefits for the first time. Citizens Advice Bureaus have continued to be a lifeline for many navigating these difficult times. I wholeheartedly thank them for everything they do and once again I thank Christine Graham for bringing the debate. Thanks.
Thank you very much. And I now call on Cabinet Secretary Aileen Campbell to respond to and wind up the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you, Christine Graham, for giving us the opportunity to acknowledge and reflect on the work of the Citizens Advice Bureau Service and Citizens Advice Scotland. And we have heard some well-deserved praise from members for their local bureau, and I would like to add my voice to that chorus of appreciation. The support the Bureau Service provides to our communities is enormous, and this has been particularly evident during the coronavirus pandemic. But I'd also like to pay tribute to my colleagues Rona Mackay and Christine Graham, who through their contributions this evening have disclosed that they have volunteered or served on the board of Citizens Advice Scotland. And so I know and can imagine just how pertinent and important this debate has been personally to both those members. And indeed, I would like to thank all members who have taken part and described so vividly just how important the Bureau and the Citizens Advice Scotland has been to them as in their time as MSP. In 2020, overall sponsorship of Citizens Advice Scotland and the Bureau service within the Scottish Government was transferred to my portfolio responsibility, and my officials and I have worked hard to establish a strong relationship with the service based on collaboration and a shared passion for the greater good of our communities and citizens. And I welcome the opportunity to meet with the Chief Executive and the Chair of the Board during that time, and where will we set the foundations for that strong relationship. And I know that whoever's in my role going forward in this Parliament and in the Government will continue to build on that work in the future. Now, the Citizens Advice Bureau service was established at the outbreak of the Second World War back in 1939. That was mentioned by Rona Mackay in her remarks. So it has been part of our communities for as long as most of us can remember. And since the 1970s, the Bureau in Christine Graham's constituency have worked tirelessly to serve their local communities. In my own constituency, Clydesdale Citizens Advice Bureau is a comparative youngster dating from 1990, but it too has been providing the same service, the support and a listening ear for more than 30 years. All are supported at a national level by Citizens Advice Scotland. And during the pandemic, as others have rightly recognised, the Citizens Advice Service has worked even harder to help people. And that's only been possible thanks to the remarkable commitment of the army of volunteers who have continued to give their time and energy to their local communities throughout this incredibly difficult and challenging time. It is this embodiment of that selflessness and care and of community spirit that represents all that is best about our communities across the country. And I would like to take this opportunity to provide my heartfelt thanks to each and every one of them. The voluntary effort found across Scotland has been essential in the country's response to COVID. And from World War II to now, while times have changed, challenges may differ, what has remained a constant is that care, compassion that has been so pivotal in the work of Citizens Advice Scotland. As a government, we have supported those at the sharp end during the pandemic by quickly responding to the changing situation. For example, we made almost £800,000 available to Citizens Advice Service from the Wellbeing and Immediate Priorities Fund, including support for the establishment of a national helpline in April 2020, connecting people with their local bureau when they sought help, and the purchase of protective equipment and adaptations to premises so that local bureau offices could operate safely. In August 2020, we also allocated an additional £600,000 from the debt advice levy to help Bureau deal with increased demand for debt services and debt advice across the country. For the Citizens Advice Service, including grants agreed before the pandemic, our total investment in the network in 2020-21 is almost £8 million. Crucially, as part of this, more than £1.4 million has been used to support people still struggling from the impact of welfare reforms. In a difficult year to do so, Bureau have built and maintained partnerships with over 550 organisations across the public and voluntary sectors to ensure clients do not fall through the gaps. For example, the Pennycook Bureau in Christine Graham's constituency, working with local children and families teams to deliver income maximisation advice and support to social work clients with children on the at-risk register or under home supervision. And another one closer to Christine Graham's constituency in the, is the Roxburgh and Berwickshire Bureau, working with Berwickshire Housing Association to promote digital inclusion and provide a digital buddy to local people needing a helping hand to access benefits online. We have also continued to fund the Citizen Advice Network's Money Talk team service, which aims to ensure that people are receiving all the benefits that they are entitled to and are not paying more than they need to for basic goods and services. And we've backed that service up by £1.5 million this year. In the first 2 years of delivery up to October 2020, it has supported almost 27,000 clients across Scotland. Of those, more than 14,300 clients are better off by a total of almost £24 million. And my colleague, the Minister for Business, Fair Work and Skills, and his team have also benefited from the network's willingness to collaborate. Throughout this financial year, and with a view to the establishment of the new consumer advocacy body, Consumer Scotland, officials have worked with Citizens Advice Scotland to take forward a new programme of consumer advocacy, and that's focused on championing the voice of bureau clients at both a local and national level. And it's gone hand in hand with the new governance arrangements for Citizens Advice Scotland's advocacy work, including a co-design approach to advocacy that harnesses the talents of both bureau and Citizens Advice Scotland policy colleagues. In this way, the bureau network and the work of Citizens Advice Scotland, which supports it, will continue to form an essential part of consumer advocacy in Scotland. Presiding Officer, tonight we have had a really positive debate about CAS, and we've all talked about the numbers, the stats, the facts, the figures and the levels of investment. But I think Christine Graham is absolutely right to root this back to the people behind the numbers. As she said, the facts behind the face behind the facts. The story that Christine Graham shared of the woman's life that had spiralled out of her own control, the trauma, the anxiety, the strain that she and her family will have been existing in, was patiently, it was purposely sorted out with a holding a metaphorical hand on to help this woman navigate a really complex benefit system, and through that patient support, help her emerge with confidence to find a job and a brighter future, recognising that lady's talents, her assets, her ability to be able to have autonomy and agency in her own life. I think that story epitomises the importance of the service provided by CAS, and long may that continue. And it is this example that I think is really critical for us to ensure that going forward we can continue to support and continue to fund and collaborate with the Bureau and the Citizens Advice Scotland to help meet our shared priorities to tackle poverty and to improve wellbeing in our communities. The pandemic has also created, in effect, a digital and phone-based revolution advice provision almost overnight, and that in turn has prompted a desire for change across the advice sector that I know we can harness and use in the future to create a modern multi-channel advice service able to serve the needs of everyone in our communities. And it's that change of culture and practice that has been prompted by COVID, albeit harsh and brutal impact of COVID, which has been felt for so many. It's that positive change that prompted us to set up the Social Renewal Advisory Board to try and capture and harness some of that positive impact to ensure that we don't lose it, that we can continue to see the benefits for people going forward. And indeed, in their report, they had a number of calls for action, including how we consider to continue support for those providing support for those with financial problems and personal debt issues. So, to conclude, Presiding Officer, it has been an incredible, insightful debate with much passion for what has been provided by CAS throughout many, many years and generations. I think the story that Christine Graham shared, though, however, brings it back to its purpose. It's about helping people, helping them to realise their own potential, helping them to navigate through really difficult situations in their life to go on to a brighter future. Citizens Advice Scotland have been doing this now for since 1939, so here's to a brighter future for them going forward, for many decades to come, to enable us to have that fairer Scotland that I know all of us share as an aspiration and hope for the future. So thank you, and thank you to Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate on Citizens Advice Scotland, and I now close this meeting.